Thank you very much, and thanks for organizer for inviting me to talk about palliative care in Alzheimer's patient. Palliative care is not a really sexy topic, and palliative care in Alzheimer's patient is less, if it's possible. But I will try to show you that we can do a lot of things for the patients. What's palliative care? There is many definitions, but I will try just to stick at the last one, 2002 for WHO, which is active care for the best quality of life for patients and family who provide a relief of pain and other distressing symptoms, who affirm lives like and consider dying like normal process. That means that we neither hasten or postpone death, and we integrate psychosocial aspect of the care all during the process and the bereavement process for the family and caregiver. Oops. This is the Cicely Sanders, which is founding palliative care. And as you can see, she was 85 years old in this meeting in St. Christopher Hospices, and she was already still welcoming visitors. And as you can see, visitors are looking to her like very strong intensity, because she was a memory, experiences, and people who you are very happy to meet. The palliative care development in Europe is different in different countries. This is a mapping done by my colleague from Spain, Carlos Centenos. And it will be updated this year, but you can see that there is maximum difference between country in the development services considering by the population. The patient is the people who want to care about physical needs, but not only psychological, existential, and the social needs. And not only the patient, but also families and caregivers. But we are in a society who are denying the elderly people and denying death, suffering, and disability. I just want to show you with a few advertisements. Some are in French, I'm sorry, but you will have one in English, showing that the subliminal message sent to us by the media is that you have to be young, healthy, and rich. And this is an advertisement for the woman of my age, if you want to have a nice skin. And the name of the device is No Age, forbidden to be old. But the girl who is there is probably 16, maybe 18. And she's supposed to sell the product to the elderly woman like me. And this is very interesting to see, because it's a very, very strong message. And what the people ask to the scientists is to be forever young. And the old people, when they are shown, they are always, this is an advertisement for physician. For prostatic problems. And the old people are to be as young as possible, and I think it's also sometimes some pathetic. And some advertisements is totally horrible, like this one. It was one for internet access. I don't give the names, and it was said that what do you need to have internet if you don't know how to use it? And I think this is injurious, but it was on an advertisement on the bus and everywhere in the city. And we have also to be a super if you get aging, if you get old, you have to be a super old. And if you remember the National Geographic of 2000 about secretly living longer, you have a very, very old, super old, like this guy who are doing skiing, water skiing at the age of 103. But I'm not able to do that right now. And also the old Japanese people growing carrots in his garden. But the real life, normal life, what you see every day is that. This is an old Greek woman giving water in a garden, and she's enjoying life in a Greek island. probably with all the family and friends around. But it's less sexy, I'm sorry. People are dying older, thanks for the medical progress, and we have to thank medical progress. But it means that even in a poor or less developed country, aging could become a problem. If you see where the patients are going to die, many European countries, they are dying in the hospital. Few are dying at home, and some quite a lot at the nursing home. But if you look at the wishes of the patient, they would like to die at home. What's the challenge? What is it a problem to die at the hospital? It's not a good place to die because the older patients are very often over-treated or under-treated. They don't get optimal control symptoms. There is a lot of ethical issues and economic issues, and nobody takes care of the patient's wishes of preference. If you look more in the dementia, I don't have to explain to you the demographic problem or statistic problem about dementia and the increasing incidence with aging population. But what we can see everywhere is that dementia people are dying in the nursing home many times. In France, is more than 50% of the people dying in a nursing home who had dementia. And there is some barrier to the palliative care in the dementia patient. We have a very poor public and professional awareness and a knowledge deficit on the specific needs. There is difficulties on symptom assessment and difficulties to establish a prognosis. There is a problem for the caregiver about the meaning on the family, about the meaning of the care and the slow dying of the patient. And we can arrive at least at a burnout of the caregiver on the family, and sometimes there is some violence around that. And there is also ethics and economics concerns. If you look very often, people who are doing palliative care with cancer, I think, but there is something specific about suffering in dementia. What they do need palliative care because they don't feel, they don't are in communication, maybe they don't need palliative care. I just want to explain that the dementia people need palliative care because the gradual loss of autonomy and control is painful. The psychiatric symptoms like disillusion and hallucination, behavioral issue, aggression, agitation. At the end of stages, aspiration, cachexia, which is loss of weight, fever, infection, pain. All these symptoms are difficult in the patient with dementia. I just want to focus about, if I have time, about the pain. I will be very, very quick. That in an elderly, the pain is common but neglected and undertreated. As you can see, in nursing home, the incidence is very high. In many studies, there's more than 60% of the patients who experiment pain. And this is exactly the same percentage than the pain in cancer. It's undertreated because the patient is reluctant to report pain, and for dementia people, it's very difficult to assess the pain. And there is also a fear of opioid use for non-cancer patients. It's difficult to manage because those patients are very medical, multiple medical issues. The dementia could be a problem for the communication. There is sensory impairment and disability. And the assessment is difficult because the patient expects pain with aging, and there is some fear of test or investigation. And there is also the meaning of the pain in a cultural aspect in some country. We cannot use the tools, the tool we use usually on a pain clinic. And with people with cognition, we use very often a behavioral scale. And Doloplus is a French scale now validated in many languages. But there is many tools. I don't mind the tools. The more important is to use the tools. And we can use opioid treatment in the elderly people, but we have to be very careful, start slow and go slow, and manage and prevent the side effects. What I want to say is that we don't only need the pills to relieve the patients or to be in communication and to be caring of the patient. And many caregivers use massage, but everything around the massage, every technique have a name. But the most important, if the people who are doing that have to like to do that. And in my unit, there are some people who like Chinese or, I don't know, Thai. I don't know the name, Japanese. Does it matter for me? What I'm happy if nurses want to spend 1 hour with the patient and really be in communication with the patient. You can use a lot of techniques like heart therapy. This is a picture of the dementia patient, and she was not really able to write, but she already write somewhere that the family, she missed the family. And we can use also the music therapy and a lot of therapy. Again, it doesn't matter in my mind which kind of therapy is it. If the people want to do that and have a little enthusiasm, they can do a miracle. There is a lot of other challenges with the patient at the stage of dementia, and one of the most prominent in geriatrics fields is always around the nutrition. This is maybe a cultural aspect and French aspect. We know that in France, nutrition is very, very important, and we are always there is always conflict around the nutrition when the patient are not able to eat, he have swallowing disorder, or I don't know, because the family or caregivers want to feed the patients, and they are pushing to do artificial nutrition or tube feeding, and is always controversial about yes or no, and the palliative care is there just to push the third way to do and to try to find a solution for everybody and avoid the problems. One picture is missing. Does it matter? What the suffering in dementia, there is for the family is the prolonged grief, because from the starting of the diagnosis and until the end for the family and caregivers and for the patient is only losses, and is very difficult. One point is when the patient needs to be in a nursing home, the time of the transfer is also very difficult for families, and for the patient there is a lot of guilt. And the distress associated with the decision-making process when we include the family is also difficult. And there is a lot of conflict around that, about ambivalence and guilt regarding end-of-life decision. And ambivalence and guilt is more and more often now with the young generation, when we have a family, the new family with the children, with many beds, many women, and complicated family. This is the picture I wanted to show before. This is an artificial feeding, and this is a natural feeding. And as you can see, the nutrition is not only a question of calories, it's also a question of sharing, it's a social event, it's a pleasure, it's also the last thing the family can do with the patient. Sometimes the last pleasure the patient can have. And we already always try to explain to everybody that it's better to try to eat in a proper, normal way. What the issues? There is too few resources, too few staff in France. In France, I don't know, I know that in other countries they have many more staff in a nursing home, but in France, the standard is a 1.4 by bed, which is very, very low, and it's very difficult to work with this kind of staff. There is a lack of acknowledgement, lack of training, and as always, a reluctance to change. But if you do a proper appropriate training, like this was a study of Marilyn Williams, implementation of a guideline in a patient with dementia about pain treatment. You can see that after the implementation of the guideline, the consumption of drugs was increasing significantly. Sorry. What the EAPC, which is the European Association for Palliative Care, are doing for promoting palliative care for people with dementia? We have producing three booklets with the WHO, is European WHO, and you can find those booklets on the website in Copenhagen. And there is some special chapter in this booklet about dementia and palliative care. It was a joint event with the European Geriatric Society in the European Parliament to try to do a manifesto trying to establish palliative care for older people like a human right, and also a white paper on dementia, and I forget to write it down here now, but it's also a task force groups working in on dementia and palliative care in the EAPC. You can find these resources on the website of the WHO. This is also to see that there is that it could be a lot of sharing between caregiver and the patients. And this is to invite you to come to the next our next congress in Prague in end of May and two June is the European conference, and you are invited to submit abstract and to share your experience with the palliative care people. If you need more information, you can go to our website. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Professor. Are there any questions? We have 2 or 3 minutes for questions. Can you help me to see? Are there any questions? Go ahead. Your chance to ask a question. Okay, I don't see any raised hands. Well, then I have a question, a quick, brief question. Do you suggest that palliative care in the course of the disease becomes an issue? In the course of the disease?
I think this is the same dilemma that in the cancer. In my mind, earlier you start, better is it. Because it's easier to prevent the problems than to just do intervention in a crisis, which is too late many times. If you are waiting that the families are in a full burnout, is too late. If you are waiting that the pain is too... if the patient is suffering for many years, 3 or 3 years, it's very difficult to relieve the pain. If you, every time, it's the same for the nutrition. If you start earlier, you don't need, you prevent a lot of things. That my mind, it should be a collaboration, early collaboration between the two people. Or probably to put on the training of the geriatrician sometimes to learn palliative care. You don't need to have a palliative care specialist, you need just to train a geriatrician also in palliative care. Okay.
So it's an interdisciplinary approach, and to involve people from all disciplines, I guess this is the message also of this session. Thank you so much. I say a special thanks to all the wonderful presenters that we had this afternoon. I think they all did a wonderful job in improving our knowledge on the presented topics. And we will close on time this session, but I was told to tell you 2 more organizational things. And one is please, please fill out the evaluation form, because only if you do this, also the organizers know how the conference did to you if you felt good about it. So please fill out the form so everybody can learn from your experience. And please do give the headsets back. That's the second message I was told to tell you. And if you rent them outside at the door. I say thank you for your participation and good afternoon.